We've all had conversations about these apps and people who get stuff done for us. These are very deep-rooted conversations, right? We've had with our friends and families. Anything can be done. Like, there are apps to do everything. So we meet these people every day. Like, they delivered dinner last night. They're going to deliver lunch today. And they drove us here today morning. And we meet on average 2 to 3 of them personally, and we see so many of them on roads. Today, let's get to know them. Let's get to know who they are, why they do this, and let's get to know ourselves. What are we doing in their lives? As someone who has the capability and privilege to design and build and uses these platforms every day. So, for the last 2 years, I've been trying to understand how does it feel to be one of them? How does it feel to be a gig employee? After studying experience design, I went on to study a little bit of urban studies, and I just wanted to see what all other problems are there. And I was really drawn by this informal employment platform economy domain. And I tried to understand a little bit of platform economy and informal labor, but mainly worked towards intra-city logistics, tempos and trucks and cabs and autos. And pursued my interest at Dunzo as design and researchers. Currently, I'm just interested in the platform itself. So how many of you use Dunzo or heard Dunzo? Can I just like, oh, nice. So we are a 24/7 delivery app. We kind of promise that we deliver anything from anywhere in your cities. But when we make this promise, most of this lies, the responsibility lies in our partners' hands because they're the one who are actually doing this. It's very important for us to understand the deeper issues of them, the whole informal employment itself. So a platform economy, in a simpler word, is like a matchmaking web app or a website. You've got like one person who needs something, another person willing to do it for exchange of money. And so there are partners, there's a platform itself, and there are users who are us. Let's get to know partners first. Who are these people, right? So let's go through a 4 set of people. And I thought it was relevant to group them by age, and I'll tell you more about them. Someone from 18 to 22, who's like a student, mostly. Someone who's a good student, like he's doing good at school, and he does it part-time. Some of the time, they are migrants living in PG or hostels. Some of the time, they live with their parents in the cities. They do this for short-term goals, mostly. Then they have a very hopeful future, right? They have a lot of opportunities to go for. So they are like, I'm not going to do this forever. I'm going to do this till I buy a jeans or a phone. Or take care of my expenses, fuel or cigarettes, stuff like that. And there are these dropouts. Has anyone have any cousins or friends, brothers who are like dropped out of schools or colleges, not doing good? There's this like, I don't care about this. I'm going to do something else. And those are these guys who wants to pick up something else and see if that works out. Most of them are from Polytechnic or ITI kind of courses. Then there are these explorers who are exploring their career options, who are first-time job seekers, mostly graduate or a polytechnic or a dropouts again. They're very hopeful about the future. They've migrated to, they've moved to cities looking for jobs. But while they're looking, they can't be just not earning and at a friend's flat, right? They have to pay rent. They have to take care of expenses. So they tried this out, and they know that they're going to get the job. They're not going to do this forever. Then there is rebels. I really like this group of people who are like, I don't like the hierarchy in the office because the places where I work has a lot of hierarchy and like these bad bosses, and they're like, I'm not going to listen to anyone. I'm going to be my boss. I want to go at my own time. I don't want to wear like a formal attire or something. Like, I'll do whatever I want. Then there is go-getters who are like mostly, they figured out what this platform economy is. They work for a lot of other platforms. They figured out the most efficient way to earn in what platform, how. They also know a lot of tricks about this. Then there are this ex-delivery professionals, not just delivery. You guys have seen them. So these guys who come for your credit card bank verification documents, or they come for fixing your water purifiers, or the guys who work in two-wheeler finance or agents. Mostly their work is around two-wheelers itself, so they want to just take a slight shift to this and still keep the dignity of the work intact. Then there's people who are men who are 30, 35 plus or above, who are mostly a family person who might have been in a loan, who has to pay, working in part-time. These guys I've met people who are technicians in IT companies to construction workers who have like graduated to a superior level. Then there are these businessmen on break, which is like entrepreneurs who have opened this phone recharge shops or pawn shops, who mobile recharge, all this, they kind of face this loan and they're like, you know what, it's not working out for me, let me do this for part time and pay off my loan and come back to this. But there are also other correlations that you could draw. The students live alone, they don't have to go home early, and they drive faster, they don't mind running up and down, going into apartments, delivering food. The first day job seekers are quite hopeful, but they're not married yet, they're living alone and they want to figure this out, but they're not sure they want to do this. The go-getters have recently, let's say, married or have a small family, 5-year, 10-year-old kid, so they have that kind of responsibilities when they're nuclear families. Most of the migrants are nuclear families, so they need to, if the wife is working, the husband has to take up the responsibility of dropping the kid or taking the kid from, like, school. Then family man who's also, one of the interesting thing is, this group of people who are, whenever I spoke to them, the themes are very helplessness and like survival, because there is a slab in these jobs which are like, if you can't, there's no matter how many years of experience you have, you cannot go more than 25,000 per month because that's a manager level salary. So they feel like there is, I need to earn, because at this point your kids are grown up and you have more expenses and they have to go home early, they have other responsibilities, and the go-getters sometimes come from a very good work background, like they know how to formally dress, they know how to speak English. There are a lot of correlations that you could connect. So they have different needs, right? How do they choose a platform? Which app to work for? Which company to work for? So let me give you a day idea. What are the apps are there? What are the problems we normally are used for? In the morning, 7 to 11, you have food, grocery, most of it moves. Then people start moving to head. They go to work, so there's bike, taxi. Then again, lunch. Then people start moving back. Then again, lunch. There's medicines. There are, these are, I'm talking about not the services that we get, like the massage. These are like proper entrepreneurs who are skilled to do that. But this is a very low barrier entry. You just need to know how to drive and you could do these jobs. So this is a group of people. How do they understand the platform? How do they know what platform, like they have to choose, that how do they understand it? How do they understand this concept of app? How does it work? Because they've never worked on this before, right? So today I want to try this. Let's actually try. Let's try to understand one platform that we use. And there's this Uber, it's a great product, made our lives easy. We almost use it every day. Open your Uber app for me, please. I want to see it at this scale, what happens. Hamburger icon, and you got a number below your name. How many of you have not noticed this before? Okay, so everyone knows there's a rider rating, right? Let's just do like a ranking in the room. And we'll start with 4. Raise of hands if your rating is above 4. Cool. Just look around. Let's just understand how, because this is how the riders have thought about us, right? So drop your hands if you're below 4.2. Keep your hands up and drop your hands if you're below 4.2. 4.3, 4.4, 5, 4.5, 4.6. I see a lot of hands going on. Yeah, 4.7. I'm done. 4.8. Cool, I see like 1, 2, 3. Okay, 3. So 4.9. Got like one topper there. 4.9. 4.95? Okay, so you're the one. Imagine if we have to figure out how to get this number. Imagine we don't know anyone at Uber. We don't know how algorithms work. Imagine this number means our livelihood, our rent, our school, our kids' school fees, and EMIs. And what will we do? We'll ask him. What are you doing that you're getting this high number? And these are related to other things also. Like we've thought, oh, maybe I'm all getting Indica all the time because my rating is low. So we've also made stories. So we'll ask him, what are you doing so good? That he'll be like, maybe I speak the same language, that's why drivers like me. Maybe I'm always on time. Maybe my pickup location is easy. Maybe I close the door softly. Maybe I don't yell on phone in the cab. There's so many things, but it's all qualitative understanding of the rider. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to understand an algorithm. We are trying to understand this complex code by stories, by meaning making. We are just trying to understand. Isn't this all what we've done as like humans since beginning? We've made up stories about gods. We've made up stories about nature. And we're still validating stories which have been done like hundreds of years ago. So making up stories and validating is what we're trying to understand this, right? It's a very beautiful narrative. This gets me up every day. How do they understand this algorithm with their limited knowledge of technology. Because experiences are made up of stories. They're nothing but stories. But the important point is, it doesn't matter if I've collected 500 stories. I can't get insights of it unless I learn who's the teller of the story, who's telling the story. What are their perspectives? What do they believe in? And they are irrational sometimes. They are illogical. They have their own political, regional, and so many angles to it. Very irrational in its own way, but you have to understand it. You can't judge it, but you have to understand. If you don't understand the perspective, the stories will not make sense, and you'll become like one biased collection of stories. So one of the major narrative in this jobs are money. So they're doing it for money, right? Who's doing their first jobs right now? First jobs in their lives. Cool. So I remember my first job. I was like damn proud, send my offer letter to my dad, and I am going to like add value to the family and society. I'm independent. It's all about money, right? Second job, is it still about the money? Third, as we switch, we change so many factors. We choose our employees based on so many other things, and money is not the only thing. So what do these people want? Look at how easy of work, how difficult or easy to do this. One of the bike taxi drivers is like, see, sir, I don't have to get down and go up on a building. I get down. The guy comes and he goes, so I'm like quite safe. I don't have to do a lot of work. Distance, how far do you have to go from work and how much do you have to run? Earning, obviously, money. Respect, can I tell someone about I'm doing this? Reference, who referred me? Is there someone who can help me through the first few months of it? Timings, what times you have to work because I have other part-time work. Rules, how many rules are there? Will there be like a police guy in our group who will tell the company that I'm doing something or not? Or do I have to sign up on the same time, like log in on that time? If I don't, will they cut money? Language, because one of the English, if you know language, it's difficult to talk to you. So sometimes it's difficult if you don't know language to work on this platform, even to understand the app itself. Safety, how safe is it? Because of their own, like maybe speed and the time that you work, the areas you work in, we'll have to wear uniform. That's a major problem, by the way. Like there's a lot of issues, I'll come to that. Payout cycle, is it a weekly, daily, monthly, bi-weekly? Vehicle type. What kind of vehicle I have? I have a bike or a scooter. I have space to keep the box, or how much mileage does my vehicle give? How much can I really save on the fuel? So, but it's like money though. Like, it's about money, right? Let's go deep. Like, I would ask him, sir, eshtagate, sir, vardali. Like, sir, kitna bana le to abba ta. They would be like, sir, see, I earn this much. This is goes to fuel. This goes to my food, and I save this much. But I have this much loan, or I save up for like coming up festivals or something. And they would ask me, sir, how much do you earn? I would be like, I don't know, I can't tell. I'm different, like I'm wired in a way, I'm not able to discuss the numbers. Like, I would either lie or find a way to avoid it. Then I would ask, like, I'm asking questions that I'm not able to answer. I don't want to answer these questions, but I'm asking everyone. So they can see the power, privilege of researcher, right? But who do we tell this information then? Who do we tell? We tell it to our families, we tell our like friends, close friends. Because it's a very sensitive information for its own reasons. But why don't we discuss that? Why is this formal and informal employment has two different narratives about earnings? Because these guys share it with everyone. They're two guys who meet at a traffic signal, and they're like, hey, how much did you make? Okay, I made this much. And they're like, they're never going to see each other. And they're like, they sit in a group, they'll be like, oh, give me your phone, you take my phone. I'll be like, okay, how much? Why? Why are they so comfortable discussing numbers like this? Because there is this solidarity, there is this brotherhood, there is this we are together in this. Is that by design? No, it is. It is the unintended consequence of design. Because if they don't share this knowledge, if they don't share this information in terms of stories, they can't understand what platform is doing, what's happening to everyone. The incentives are different, the earning is different. How have you got this location? Why am I working in this location? How do they get to know if everyone is so safe, like, they will not make sense of it. One of the interesting things is the solidarity itself. They don't know anything about the company, but they make up more than 95% of a workforce. Informally, it's got its own pros and cons, but we are there. Why don't they know that much, and why do we know that much? Look, this whole information power, right? One of the part, I'd like to quote a partner in this. He said, sir, these platforms, no, they're not friends, they're not enemies. They're like mixed somewhere. They're like, sir, mitro no alla, shatru no alla. Kind of sums it up, yes. Because sometimes it helps you, sometimes it takes it something away from you. But you look at this symbiotic relationship, right? Because the platform, the app, raises orders. Like, they kind of tell people to, like, order from us, and they get more jobs. They're able to run more tasks, the platform makes. It's a very symbiotic relationship. Everyone is, both of them are surviving at their own scale, but they both of them are surviving. But one of the other really interesting things is these people test and research and pretty much design our platforms. And we've got in-house researcher designers and quality assurance people who can't go through those flows, who can't reproduce those bugs, because we're not doing it for survival. If we don't, we'll get a salary by the end of the day, even if I don't do it well. But no, not for them. Imagine going to office knowing that you will not get a salary, for sure. Imagine someone will send a message that you did something and you will be banned for a week. Your week salary is gone. And they have to do it. They're doing this for survival, right? I'll tell you how this thing is answered. Have you ever been in a ride where, in the beginning used to happen, now it's quite less. We're like, sir or madam, I will go far and I'll end the trip there. I will not end it here. Is that okay? Please don't tell anyone. Why? Because they figured it out, if you go into another geo and finish the trip there, you'll get more. So we had this allocation algorithm where anyone who's close to the store will get the task. So everyone will go and select sit next to the store. And that changes the space, urban space itself. One of the merchant was like, so many of your people sit there, the other customers find it very like awkward to walk in. So everything has consequences to each. And the interesting part is how they keep breaking the building. They're gaming it, they're hacking it, but they keep breaking what we have built and their own understanding. And we break it too, because we build something else and we break their understanding and they break our code. And there's this constant tussle, which is interesting because we're building, in a larger scale, zoom out, we're building a better platform. The challenge that a company like this face is one of the, how do you design for belonging? How do you design for trust? How do you design for this? They work, they belong to this. Yes, there are a lot of debates happening around the world about its legal nature of work, terms of agreement. It's a lot of, it's very happy, like, it should be happening. But I believe that they are day-to-day experiences. If they are better, they're going to be better. And it's beyond screen sometimes, because you have to train your users to talk to them properly. You have to train your merchants to talk to them properly. You have to take your support team, talk to them properly, training teams. So it needs a holistic approach to make them feel that part of this whole pyramid that I was telling, right? Let's talk about platforms now. Every technological intervention in our lives has negatives and positive impacts. We tend to dwell on the positives more, and we like maybe sometimes are blind to the negative. Well, not willfully, but we are. We'll start with the positive things that informal platform economy is doing to us, right? One, technology doesn't discriminate. If you have to stand in an auto stand somewhere in Bangalore, either you have to be some same family member or from a same communal community. If you're from Northeast and you can't just go and get a job because the company or the small shop will not be able to do a background verification, and be like, nee, I've heard stories about you somewhere and I'm not gonna just give a job. And technology doesn't discriminate that. Language, you don't have to know the language, you don't have to know the city because it is a map and anyone can come in and earn, right? Time over money, the value of self-worth. That when we have free time, we indulge and we like do nothing which is useful to anyone. But when they have free time, they actually work for someone else. They actually help someone else. So I've met this person whose name is, So he's a entrepreneur. I've been to Jainagar and Fourth Block where they sell his chudidar pieces. So he has one of those factories where he actually employs 20 people who does that. And he works bike taxi in the morning, like 7 to 11. They're like, sir, why do you need, what will you do? How much do you make? He's like, 300. Sir, 300 mein kya ho chuka? Nahi sir, 300 is good because I make like 12,000 per month and I'm also talking to people and it's nice. I roam around. Why would I watch TV at home? So the value of their own time to something is so relevant that we don't have informal employment. Stories of life in city and people, right? These people are literally the historians of the city and they know so much about the city and the world itself. They know which flights are canceled, why they are canceled, and they know where the marriage is happening. And like they'll know, okay, there are a lot of marriages happening, so everyone goes. They know which roads are blocked. They know the nooks and corners of the city that still the maps are not able to cross. They also know where Belandur techies go normally to job. They know that most of them go to this IT park, whatever. They also know what Indranagar people eat like. So there is a lot of idea of understanding that they have. One of the interesting things is when I take rides in this bikes and cabs and auto, they tell me, sir, this land used to be like this. This land used to be like this. There used to be a this fight. One time, sir, there was a murder here. They're literally the historians of the city and they carry so much data. It's so interesting to talk to them. And ability to restart and rethink career. So I wish I could do that. Like, if you ever had a doubt and you're like, you know what, let me go take a break and do something else. But that's maybe out of our boredom. But when they can't have a chance to follow a career path or kind of laid off a job somewhere, they could actually take a break without any fear and they could try to do this while they figure out something else, which is great. Breaking barriers and shifting mindset. One of the very interesting points is that since the morning you heard the talks, but we also started to live in this abstract borders. I mean, you sit in the cab, like the gully boy scene will explain you so better. Like, the girl is crying and they're like, I'm so far, but I can't really, like, there is a barrier, right? And why? We have built it. But this breaks it. We get to walk into each other's life. We get to see other homes. We actually share, like, sir, where are you from? What do you do? Oh, I do this. So there are these small bubbles of stories happening across the city, which people getting to peek into each other's lives and what they do and what they do. Okay, what do you do, sir? I have a cousin who does computer science. They kind of take that knowledge and help them somewhere there. And it also shifts mindset. One of the major use cases that Dunzo successfully solved is menstrual health. So there is men who are very uncomfortable, cringy about talking menstrual health or delivering pads. And the more they get to see this people and humans at their own problems, it breaks that stigma, right? Like, they wouldn't really judge, maybe the first few times, but they wouldn't really judge a guy ordering condoms or a girl ordering cigarettes because they will get used to it. It's part of the life. There's this progressive mind shift happening and it's beautiful. It's come to negatives. It's not intended, but unintendedly these things happen. One is it breaks social contracts. So imagine a city market and you've got like all the shopkeepers and you've got the tempo stand or auto stand. They've made a verbal contract for generations, right? I am here because I will work for you. You will give me work. Now a platform comes into a place. They will be like, you know what? They'll offer the businessman. They'll be like, I'll give you a less money because there is someone else who's not getting jobs. So that guy will come and help you. Like, okay, maybe less money. They'll try it out. But these people, there is this sense of alienation, sense of someone avoiding you, helplessness. There is this sense of anger, right? Which all turns into anger. So there have been cases where a platform tempo goes into city market and they get vandalized. And the native stand people make those vehicles unload everything and call the owner and pick it up. And why are they doing? Obviously, anger, all that is there. But you have to understand the deep-root issues of it. Why is it coming? Because it's alienation. Same way with our city auto drivers also. Like, they're like, sometimes they think the native Bangaloreans will always call us. They will not book the cab. Sometimes they're like, why are you paying the platform? Why don't you just pay me? And there is also that idea when a tempo stand guy said, sir, you see center part of the city, you know, Malleshwaram and all, these guys will come to us. But if you go in the outskirts, suburbs, all these migrants, they book apps. That's why we normally charge more for that. It doesn't give a choice. So when it hits, when a technology change comes, it doesn't really give a choice to you. One of the personal example is my dad runs a printing press. So we used to do that letter printing press where you had a block and paper and everything. Suddenly there was this news, it's called desktop publishing, PageMaker, Dreamweaver, Photoshop, CorelDRAW. We didn't know what to do. So I had to pick it up and learn. But I remember that time in my family, you had to learn, there was no other choice. So when there's no choice, the whole relationship starts with a conflict. There's a whole relationship starts with denial that they never want to be on this platform for the first time. It's very difficult to unionize and fight against it, such global corporates. It disturbs the balance. It brings a lot of people from outside and the native workers feel very injustice. One of the auto drivers said this, said all in his life, he has built understanding of the city as his map. It's like an intellectual property of his business. And suddenly it becomes public and it's like, what do I do now? So it breaks balance. Then it's also, they're not designed for respect. The careers are quite difficult. If I wear a Dunzo t-shirt and walk into a mall and a partner wears a Dunzo t-shirt, walks into a mall, it's two different companies, two different t-shirts. It's also, a lot of issues are there. Like one of the interesting things is Dunzo partners can pay by card. So at Empire and other restaurants, when they go to take something, the restaurant owners can't really figure out, are you a delivery partner or user? So they're like, this is better for me because now I'm not treated the same way. Hey, like, come this side, don't disturb the customers. But it biases a lot towards users and its partners. I'm sure you've all read app reviews of these apps, but have you read app reviews of the partners or the people who work for it? Another simple example is when you book a cab or an auto, the guy goes like U-turns, signal and everything. He comes in front of you, you could cancel it. You know that's a cab, you canceled. The cab guy will never know who it was. Where does that anger go? So now that we've spoken all that, let's just look at a previous, maybe like a subliminal understanding of them. They earn less than us, no. They earn almost like an IT employee at a beginning scale from other tier 2 cities which they move. Because they are underqualified. No, they're not underqualified. Maybe educational-wise, yeah, maybe, but they're way more smart in their empathy. They can negotiate, they can travel, they can find things that we can't, and they have more time sense than us. They have more polite, like I met this bike taxi driver. So like, sir, you are a guy, so I'm sitting comfortably, but if it was a girl, I would be like sitting aage, so that the girl doesn't feel so. Gentlemen. And not everyone's good and bad, like same way how we are, but there are. Because they couldn't get anything else. No, we can't get anything else. We studied 6 to 9 years to do one job and we do variations of it. These guys have done everything. Remember the time where the softwares that you learned were obsolete and suddenly you have to change? This happens every week or a month for them. So they're more resilient to the life itself than us. So, and also it's not more physical, less intellectual. As I told you, it's damn intellectual and it's more emotional. There's a lot of emotional labor that it carries. So, three stories, yes. Our story is that we get everything done. Platform stories are, we are successful, we are profitable, all that. What are their stories then, their perspective towards this? There is a unfair race that's happening. We want to reach home early. We want to get our food fast. Companies want to reach that goal in the quarter. Everyone's running a race. But the race that these people are running are against odds that they're not in their control. They're not in their understanding. But imagine running a race knowing that you will fail. Imagine these underrepresented perspectives of people who literally run the companies on ground and yet finish the race as runner-ups and getting back next day and running again for someone solving someone else's problem. So one thing I would like to finish this talk is there is a problem in the world. You're part of the problem. You're not the source of the problem, you're part of the problem. And you're aware of this problem, and it doesn't impact you in any way. It puts you in two places. One, you're privileged. You have to understand that and be aware of that privilege and take right decisions. Or if you're a resource, or if you have the resources and you have the passion to solve it, it's your responsibility to solve it. And that's pretty much it. Thank you.